Hello and welcome to our worship. Our focus today is on Jesus' teaching in John chapter 3 about the new birth we all need and which he offers to all through the work of his Spirit in our lives. Our opening hymn, O Praise Ye the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, you have created the heavens and the earth and made us in your own image. Teach us to discern your hand in all your works and your likeness in all your children. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns supreme over all things, now and forever. Amen. Our Bible reading from John chapter 3, beginning at the first verse, is brought to us by Helen Dodds.
Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'm aware that talk of the kind of new birth spoken of in our gospel reading can elicit mixed reactions. On a positive note, one person reported, "My mother loved seeing me being born again, and she said that this time it was a lot less painful for her." Others, though, delight when those who proclaim themselves to be born again hit problems. In that vein, the story is told of a couple who had been very enthusiastic in declaring themselves to be born again Christians and had two daughters and a third on the way. Unfortunately, the wife had a terribly difficult labour and lost her faith in the process. So the story concludes, they ended up with Faith, Hope and Emma. To some, there's a joy in celebrating the fact that they're born again. Others, both inside and outside the church, have an equally strong dislike of that kind of language and way of thinking. And maybe sometimes it is used in a rather arrogant way. But the New Testament speaks consistently of the Christian life as being a new life, which must begin with a new birth. Here in John chapter 3, we see Jesus use the actual phrase born again or born from above. And we're going to look at what he says under three headings. First of all, the new birth, why it's necessary, from verse 1 to 3. Then, secondly, the new birth and how it's possible, from verses 4 to 8. And then the new birth and where it is available, from verses 9 to 15. So first of all, the new birth and why it's necessary. This chapter, you may remember, centres around a man named Nicodemus, a Pharisee who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. One night, he came to see Jesus and expressed approval as to what he'd seen of the Lord's ministry. "Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with them." Jesus' reply is quite abrupt, indicating that what he's looking for from a man like Nicodemus, or any other person for that matter, is far more than simple good wishes or compliments. "Truly, truly, I say to you," Jesus replies, "unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus was a man of some standing, being identified as a Pharisee. Well, to us, the word has become associated with hypocrisy and self-righteousness. In Jesus' day, though, the Pharisees were generally known as sincere and spiritual people, concerned both to keep God's law for themselves and help others do so as well. Yet Jesus is clear that that in itself is not enough. There's a need to, for Nicodemus, for anybody, to be born again if they're to become a part of God's kingdom. For some, that may be an immediately attractive sounding option. The chance for a fresh start has an obvious appeal if a person feels they've made a mess of things or that their life has clearly taken a wrong turning. For others, the first reaction to Jesus' words about being born again is much more negative. It can feel like being asked to go back to square one in life. And maybe Nicodemus was thinking something like that. Hang on a minute, I thought I was doing pretty well, not only in general terms, but spiritually speaking too. Being on the Jewish ruling council was quite an honour, and it gave him a standing both politically and religiously. Many people share those kind of hesitations today. Yet Jesus insists that worldly standing counts for nothing in gaining a place in God's kingdom. You must be born again. John Wesley was asked why he preached so often on these words, "You must be born again," to which his answer was, "Because you must be born again." So on to our next question about the new birth. How is it possible? From verse 4, Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who's born of the Spirit." We're relieved to hear that the new birth isn't a physical process. Neither parents nor children would find that very attractive. Instead, Jesus says, the Spirit gives birth to spirit. In other words, it's God's Holy Spirit that brings a person the new birth. Becoming a Christian is, of course, partly an act of the will, saying, "I'm sorry for my sins. From now on, I will follow Jesus." But those thoughts and words of ours are only a part of it. God is at work inside us through his Spirit, making us new from within, giving new life to a part of us that was previously dead by the supernatural action of his Holy Spirit. Jesus compares it to the coming of the wind, partly in its invisibility. You can, of course, see the effects of the wind. You can hear it if it's strong enough. But you can't see the wind itself. Moving particles of air are invisible. And God's Spirit is similarly invisible to the human eye. We may see its effects. Particularly over time, the person who's been born again will begin to change, to become more like Jesus himself, to display what the Apostle Paul calls the fruits of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. But God's Holy Spirit is as unseen as the wind. And then, like the wind, it's unpredictable. Even with the benefit of modern 20th century weather forecasts or 21st century weather forecasts, you can't tell what the wind will be like. On the 15th of October 1987, southern England and northern France were hit by what came to be known as the Great Storm. It was far smaller than the hurricanes and tornadoes some countries experienced, but it was big for the UK. And no one was prepared for it. Not even the forecasters. Michael Fish of the London Weather Centre is on videotape as saying, "Earlier on today, apparently, a woman rang the BBC and said there was a hurricane on the way. Well, if you're watching, don't worry, there isn't." But having said that, actually the weather will become very windy, but most of the strong winds, incidentally, will be down over Spain and across into France. As Jesus reminds us, though, the wind isn't bound by a forecaster's words. It blows wherever it pleases. And so it is with God's Spirit. Sometimes you might say, in seeing a person come to faith, that it was always likely to happen given their particular circumstances. But very often, a person who looks ready to come to faith never in fact does so. Whereas someone else experienced the new birth God brings and is transformed out of the blue. And all because it isn't essentially a human process, but the work of God's Holy Spirit, who acts as and when he wills. But at the same time, under our final heading, Jesus does tell us where the new birth is available. Verse 13, "No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." Jesus is referring here to what to many may seem a rather obscure incident from the Old Testament. After the Israelites had escaped from slavery in Egypt during the long period of their wanderings in the Sinai Desert, they encountered a plague of venomous snakes. The book of Numbers tells us it was the Lord's judgment on their disobedience. But God provided a remedy too. A bronze snake was to be crafted and put on a pole, with the instructions being that if a person bitten by the snakes looked up at the bronze snake provided by God, they would live. It seems pretty strange when you read of that incident in the book of Numbers, because in general, God's people were to have nothing to do with these kinds of animal images in their worship and their thoughts about God. And anyway, if you were suffering the ill effects of a snake bite, it might be the last thing you'd want to do. Yet Jesus sees the instruction to look up to the snake who was lifted up in the desert as a parallel to what people were being asked to do in New Testament times as a remedy for their sin. The Son of Man being lifted up is referring to his own death on the cross. There seem to be two parallels intended. First of all, in what appears to be rather unpleasant, being the source of the remedy. If you've been bitten by a snake, then a bronze effigy of another nasty snake on a pole wouldn't come high on your list of things you wanted to focus on. And similarly, Jesus' followers may have thought the last thing they wanted to concentrate on was his cruel execution. In both cases, though, something unpleasant is God's remedy for our need. In believing in Jesus' death for us on the cross, we find the cure for our sins. So must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Then there's the fact that in that particular Old Testament incident, the people just needed to look and to trust. In most of the worship prescribed in the Old Testament, they were much more involved in buying an animal, in bringing it for sacrifice, in laying their hands on it before it was killed. With the bronze snake, though, there was none of that, just the need to look as a sign of trust. And so it is with the death of Jesus on the cross. To see God's kingdom, more than that, to be part of it, to know eternal life, we need to be willing to be born again, to accept the supernatural work of God in our lives, remaking us from within. And our part in the process is to trust Jesus and his death on the cross for our sins, to look up in trust to him and him alone. We sing, "Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul." After which, Steve Forrester will lead us in our prayers.
Holy Spirit, living breath of God, breathe new life into my willing soul. Of the risen Lord to renew my heart and make me whole.
6 and a half, and a couple of nights ago she was crying as she was trying to go to sleep. She told us how sad she was because she was missing her friends, her family, her school, and going out for meals and doing the normal stuff. She's in a loving, safe and nurturing environment, but it made me think that there are so many that are not just children but adults too, but so many of us struggling with confinement, loneliness, hopelessness and illness. And many folk have avoided hospitals and doctors for their necessary treatments and are now finding themselves more poorly than they may otherwise have been. I'm mindful today of this Bible verse from Psalm 68 verse 8. It reads, God sets the lonely in families and leads forth the prisoners with singing. Let's pray, shall we? Let's pray. Lord God, you are high and lifted up, Master and Creator of the heavens and of the earth, Almighty, Immortal, the only wise. You are holy and magnificent, radiant with the splendour of righteousness and truth, and full of loving compassion and tender mercies. There is none like you. And we offer to you our lives and our praise this morning. Cleanse us afresh, we pray, so that our praise would rise to you like sweet incense and find favour in your sight. We are your children, Heavenly Father, and we bring to you our intercessions and petitions, having faith in you, our God. We remember to you those who in many ways have been affected by the disease that has come upon our lands, and we pray for them and ask your blessing upon them. Their struggles emotionally and physically and financially are for some much too much to bear. Grant them relief, we pray. Set the lonely in families, heal the sick, comfort those who mourn, and bring your provision to those in financial need, we pray. We also pray for those in our fellowship who have specific needs, for Derek Collins, for Derek Murphy, and for Nora Cooper. And we pray for the bereaved family and friends of Jim Mottram. We pray for our church mission. Lord God, we seek as a fellowship to grow in prayer. Grant us an intimate awareness of your Holy Spirit's presence, that we might hear from him and be empowered by his anointing. We pray for new generations of people within our influence, Help us be effective witnesses to the life of Jesus, and help us be effective in showing them the way. We pray for our resources and facilities, particularly the buildings this morning. You know our plans that we've made, and we ask you to bless them with the necessary finances to enable those visions to come to pass. We thank you for all those who give so generously to our mission here, and ask your blessing upon them too today. We also remember Jesus told us to make disciples. And for that work, we ask your anointing. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us, so that our building up of the saints has its foundation on and in you. Grant us the eyes to see what you're doing, so that we may stay close to you. We ask your blessing on all those who contribute to our fellowship here, for Andrew and his family, and for Naomi, and for our wardens and readers, and for all those who, in whatever way, work to support our church family here. Bless them, we pray, Lord Jesus. And finally, Lord, we pray for the world and its peoples. Empower your church to be a light to the nations, to be that city set on a hill for all to see. Grant us understanding of the times in which we live, so that we can witness to the turmoil found upon the earth. Help us call to you those who are lost, and grant them peace. Heavenly Father, we offer these our prayers to you in and through the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Just to add as we conclude, if you receive our emails, you will have got a letter from Helen and Sue, our wardens, about the church's finances. We're very grateful to all who gave so generously last year, so that even with only half as many services as usual, 90% of our income held up. That still leaves us around £10,000 short, though, of what we might have expected usually. So, as we do most years anyway, we're encouraging those who can to review their giving. Although, of course, we understand entirely that for a number, this will be an incredibly difficult time financially, on top of the many other struggles that everyone is experiencing. So we hope people don't feel any undue pressure in this direction. If you're not on email and would like a copy of what was sent, do give me a ring. The blessing. Go now in peace, knowing that you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring Word of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with us all and those we care for, today and evermore. Amen.